Good afternoon. It is Sunday the 27th of September at 5 p.m. and a very warm welcome to our online worship with the Butts Church. Let's start with some words from Scripture. I will sing of the Lord's great love forever. With my mouth I will make your faithfulness known through all generations. I will declare that your love stands firm forever, that you have established your faithfulness in heaven itself. You said, I have made a covenant with my chosen one. I have sworn to David my servant. I will establish your line forever and make your throne firm through all generations. The heavens praise your wonders, Lord, your faithfulness too in the assembly of the holy ones. For who in the skies above can compare with the Lord? Who is like the Lord among the heavenly beings? In the council of the holy ones, God is greatly feared. He is more awesome than all who surround him. Who is like you, Lord God Almighty? You, Lord, are mighty, and your faithfulness surrounds you. You rule over the surging sea when its waves mount up, you still them. You crushed Rahab like one of the slain. With your strong arm you scattered your enemies. The heavens are yours, and yours also the earth. You founded the world and all that is in it. You created the north and the south. Tabor and Hermon sing for joy at your name. Your arm is endowed with power. Your hand is strong, your right hand exalted. Righteousness and justice are the foundation of your throne. Love and faithfulness go before you. Shall we pray? Dear Lord, we thank you so much for your love and faithfulness that you show us every day in so many ways. We thank you that we can continue to gather together, either physically or online in this way. And we just pray that you will be with us as we hear from your word and we give you our praise this afternoon. We pray this in the name of our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. So let's join together now in singing our praises to God for his wonderful love and mercy that he shows to us. This is Amazing Grace.
Above all kings.
I wonder if you've ever considered the question, how do I know that somebody loves me? Sometimes it might seem very obvious. It might be that somebody tells us all the time how much they love us. But sometimes we might find ourselves questioning that and wanting more proof. I'll give you an example. If I think about Anne and my relationship together, I tell Anne that I love her. But if I continually do things that I know are going to wind her up, I don't offer her any help, and I just am totally selfish all the time, does the fact I tell her I love her really give her that feeling that I do? Or do I need to do something more that shows my love for her? Because I think that's how many of us will often think about things. We need to show our love, and then it should be fairly obvious. I hope that in our relationships with other people, we always show that we love them. It's not just something that we say, although it is good to tell people we love them, but they can tell from our actions. We do things that we know will make them happy. We don't do things that we know will deliberately wind them up or just are unpleasant or selfish. So I hope that young people, with your parents or brothers and sisters, they know that you love them because you tell them. But you also show them. Often it is those actions that are so important, isn't it? That's how we can show people that we don't even know very well that we love them, because they see that the actions that we do for them, and they know that this comes from a place of love. I hope that we have that same attitude towards people in church as well. We should love one another, and so can people tell that we love them because of the way that we act towards them, the things that we do for them, the fact that we often put them above ourselves and our own needs. And very especially, I hope that we do that with our God and Jesus as well, that we can show them we love them by the way that we live our lives, that we listen to God's word and try and live the life that he would want us to lead. Because I think something that is very clear is we should never be in a position to doubt God's love towards us. First of all, we know it because God tells us he loves us. We have that in the passage we're going to look at a little later. God says, I have loved you. He tells us he loves us. But he also shows us in so many different ways. One of arguably the most famous verses in the Bible is exactly about this. God showing us how he loves us. You may well recognize it. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. John 3:16. We know just how much God loves us because he sent Jesus to save us so we can have a proper relationship with him. How amazing that God loves us so much, despite all the silly things we do, that he wants to save us for himself. Phil is now going to lead us in a time of prayer.
Let's pray. Father God, I thank you that we can meet together, whether that's using technology to meet over Zoom or share an online service, or meeting in person at All Saints Church. And Lord, I thank you for the use of that building. And I thank you for Clive and Ben as they preach your word to us and as they prepare services and other activities for us to be able to engage as a fellowship together. I pray for the wider fellowship, for those who perhaps are unable to join us online or in person. I pray for those who are unwell, and I pray for those who may be feeling lonely or more isolated at the current time. Help us to be mindful of those people. I pray for the other churches in town as they get back to meeting together. Lord, I pray that you would help us all to want to meet together and not to be lethargic or lazy in our faith following the coronavirus lockdown. And Lord, I pray for the work of the food bank, and I thank you for that, even though we wish it were not necessary. Lord, I thank you for those who provide food, and I thank you for those who work in the warehouse and for those at the distribution centre. But Lord, I do pray especially for those who are needing to access the help of the food bank. Lord, we pray for the wider world. Pray for all those who are affected by the COVID pandemic, those who have been or are currently ill, but especially also for those who've lost loved ones, and for those who've lost their livelihoods or lost income. And Lord, we do pray for areas in the world that are facing particular difficulties. I think of the country of Lebanon, and pray for that country following that terrible explosion in Beirut. Lord, I pray that the infrastructure that is desperately needed can be quickly rebuilt so that people have homes to live in and hospitals to access healthcare. Also pray for the country of Yemen facing such challenges even before the coronavirus pandemic. Lord, I thank you for recent changes and agreements regarding the country of Sudan. And Lord, I thank you that it looks like there will be greater religious freedom moving forwards. And Lord, I also pray in the lead up to the American elections that the candidates would truly look to you for wisdom and authority. And Lord, I pray for our government. I pray for the very difficult and challenging situation they find themselves in. I pray as they negotiate the Brexit agreement with the European Union, that there would be honesty and integrity on both sides, and that an amicable agreement can be reached. I also pray for frontline workers in our country, and I think particularly of the police, especially in the aftermath of the death of the policeman at Croydon who was shot on duty. Lord, I do pray for their safety as they seek to keep us safe in our nation. And Lord, We are sorry for where we have failed to do what we should have done this week. And we pray, Lord, that you would forgive us for things that we have thought or said or done wrong. Lord, we thank you that we know that you can forgive us because of the death of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we pray this in his name. Amen. Let's say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Thank you very much, Phil. We are starting a new sermon series this afternoon, and we're looking at the Old Testament book of Malachi. And our first passage we're going to look at today is Malachi chapter 1, verses 1 to 5, and Danny is going to read it to us.
Malachi chapter 1 verses 1 to 5. A prophecy, the word of the Lord to Israel through Malachi. I have loved you, says the Lord, but you ask, how have you loved us? Was not Esau Jacob's brother, declares the Lord? Yet I have loved Jacob, but Esau I have hated, and I have turned his hill country into a wasteland, and left his inheritance to the desert jackals. Edom may say, though we have been crushed, we will rebuild the ruins. But this is what the Lord Almighty says. They may build, but I will demolish. They will be called a wicked land, a people always under the wrath of the Lord. You will see it with your own eyes and say, great is the Lord, even beyond the borders of Israel.
Thank you very much, Danny. Well, before we come to look at that passage in a bit more detail, let's sing again. Here is love vast as the ocean.
Here is love vast as the ocean, loving kindness as the flood. When the Prince of Life, our ransom, shed for us his precious blood. Who his love will not remember? Who can cease to sing his praise? He can eternal days. On the mount of crucifixion, fountains open deep and wide. Through the floodgates of God's mercy flowed a vast and gracious tide. Grace and love like mighty rivers poured incessant from above. And hence peace and perfect justice kiss the guilty world in love.
I know there have been some mixed emotions about people returning to school over the last few weeks. There are some people who have been quite anxious about going back because they're not quite sure what lies ahead of them, whereas maybe others are happy to get back to some semblance of normality after having been homeschooled for several months before the summer holidays. And I'm sure that same mixture of emotions are present in parents as well. In some ways, sad to see their children go back to school, but in other ways, very happy to hand education back to the teachers. I think many discovered that no matter how motivated their children might have been at the start of homeschooling, as time went on, they began to struggle more and more and lost their motivation. I wonder how many parents had what we might charitably call discussions with their children when they had told or asked their children to do something. and their children want to question them about that. I'm sure at times it must have been very frustrating. But imagine if those discussions were, and questioning was on something of a bigger level. Imagine if God's children started to argue and question the Almighty God, the ultimate authority, challenging over him over the things that he said. That is exactly what we are going to see as we look through the book of Malachi between now and just before Christmas. Today we will see clearly God's love for his people, but we will see that his people are contrary but chosen. So let's start by looking through this fascinating book together. A book which we are told in verse 1 is a prophecy, the word of the Lord to Israel through Malachi. Before we start to look and see what Malachi actually says at the start of this prophecy, it would be useful to place this book into its context, because as we know, context is key. Malachi himself doesn't give us any particular dates in what he has written, but from what he does mention, we know roughly where it falls within the history of Israel. The book was written at a time after the nations had divided in two, to the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom. The northern kingdom had been destroyed by the Assyrians in around 722 BC, and then the southern kingdom was conquered by the Babylonians and taken into exile starting from around 605 BC. The Babylonians then went on to destroy the temple, the royal palace and all the houses, and every important building in Jerusalem, as we can read in Jeremiah chapter 52. Then, after 70 years, the Persians, led by King Cyrus, conquered Babylon, and the exiles were allowed to start returning to Jerusalem, where in time they rebuilt the temple, which was completed in around 515 BC. And then there was a continued provision of priests, sacrifices, and prophets, of which Malachi was one. So we think this prophecy was written in around about 460 to 400 BC. We don't know an awful lot about Malachi himself, other than his name means messenger, which is of course very apt, as he brings the word of the Lord, and particularly a prophecy. Now that word prophecy, in some older translations, is either called an oracle or a burden, because people were supposed to feel the weight of these words and have to carry them round with them, reflecting on the message from God delivered by his prophets. If we consider the history that Israel had just gone through, we might find it funny that God considers that they need to have this burden placed upon them. Of course, when I talk about Israel now, I mean the southern tribes that have returned to Jerusalem. We might have assumed that they were very happy because after God's discipline, they had been allowed to return home and rebuild the temple. But it didn't take long for that joy to leave them and for them to fall back into old ways. And so Malachi brings the prophecy, and we see in the first part of verse 2, God's love for his people who are contrary. God's love for his people who are contrary. I have loved you, says the Lord, but you ask, how have you loved us? What a magnificent way for this word from the Lord to start, a reminder of his constant love for his people. It is something that should strike us every time we consider God's love for us. What an amazing privilege we have that the Creator of heaven and earth not only created us, but knows us. And despite all the silly things we do where we try and push him away or ignore him, he loves us. It is such a reason to praise and give thanks to God, and I hope it is something that we regularly reflect on and praise him for. And yet that is not the way that Israel have responded. Instead of giving thanks and praise, they challenge God's statement by effectively saying, oh yeah, prove it. Go on, just show us how you have loved us. We may as individuals sometimes go through times of suffering or hardship. And at times we may even feel very distanced from God or even questioned him about why he's allowed this particular set of circumstances to happen to us. But if we are honest, even in the depth of our suffering, we still know the blessings he has placed upon us and showed us in the past. We see that kind of attitude quite often in the Psalms, don't we? Such as in Psalm 89, where David says, "But you have rejected, you have spurned, you have been very angry with your anointed one. You have renounced the covenant with your servant and have defiled his crown in the dust." Verses 38 to 39. But he only says this after starting the entire Psalm by saying, "I will sing of the Lord's great love forever. With my mouth I will make your faithfulness known through all generations." Even in the depth of his misery, David couldn't deny the love that God had shown in the past. And yet here is Israel with apparently very short memories. And it's not just one or two individuals, it is the entire nation. This is a public, corporate questioning of God's love. I want you to imagine again our parent trying to homeschool their child. The child has been asked to do something and quite honestly they just had enough, and so an argument breaks out. Imagine the pain and hurt that the parent would feel if they tried to reassure their child that they still love them and the child turned around and said, "Oh yeah, well, I don't believe you. Go on then, what have you ever done that shows that you love me even a little bit?" What a shocking thing for God's people to say to him. I wonder if we are ever guilty of acting as if God has never shown anything that proves his love for us in the way that we act towards him. Or indeed, if we were asked to prove our love for God by looking at our past actions, how unremarkable our actions may seem. If you were that parent, how would you respond? Would pride get in the way and you say, "Oh, don't be silly," and just refuse to answer the question? Well, God is ever patient with us, and so he answers them to give them proof. And so from the second half of verse 2 to verse 5, we see God's love for his people who are chosen. God's love for his people who are chosen. So from the second half of verse 2 to verse 3. "Was not Esau Jacob's brother, declares the Lord. Yet I have loved Jacob, but Esau I have hated. And I have turned his hill country into a wasteland and left his inheritance to the desert jackals." To demonstrate his continual love for his people, God wants to show them how they were chosen as part of God's covenant with Abraham. And so he goes back to the father of the 12 tribes, Jacob. In the book of Genesis, we are told that when Rebekah was pregnant with Isaac's two sons, the Lord said to her, "Two nations are in your womb, and two peoples from within you will be separated. One people will be stronger than the other, and the elder will serve the younger." Genesis 25:23. Of course, normally it would have been the eldest son who became the heir of the family. But God chose to bless Jacob to bring about the covenant. And this was a choice he made before even either of the children were born. And so it's not based on any works that either of them had done, but rather God just chose Jacob to bless and to show his love to. The implications of this are made clear in the book of Deuteronomy. "For you are a people holy to the Lord your God. The Lord your God has chosen you out of all the peoples on the face of the earth to be his people, his treasured possession. The Lord did not set his affection on you and choose you because you were more numerous than other peoples, for you are the fewest of all peoples. But it was because the Lord loved you and kept the oath he swore to your ancestors that he brought you out with a mighty hand and redeemed you from the land of slavery, from the power of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. Know therefore that the Lord your God is God. He is the faithful God, keeping his covenant of love to 1,000 generations of those who love him and keep his commandments. But to those who hate him, he will repay to their face by destruction. He will not be slow to repay to their face those who hate him. Deuteronomy chapter 7, verses 6 to 10. In the same way that we've not done anything to deserve God's love or mercy, but still he gives it to us, he chose to bless Jacob. And we see that electing love through Jacob's life. The way that Esau sold him his birthright so easily. The way in which it was eventually Jacob who received Isaac's blessing. And the way that Jacob was humbled and received prosperity, and ultimately through his 12 sons, who themselves became the father of each of the 12 tribes of Israel. The way in which the nation of Israel had been blessed should have been very, very clear to see. The way in which Joseph rose to the position he did in Egypt and so was able to help his brothers in the famine. The saving of God's people from slavery in Egypt through the Passover. The crossing of the Red Sea, the giving of the law, provision of food and water in the desert, the conquest of the Promised Land, the mighty victories of King David, and the promise made for his line, and more recently the second exodus from Babylon, being able to return to Jerusalem and rebuild the temple. But again they felt the need to ask, how have you loved us? How sad. It reminds me of a scene from The Simpsons where Bart is talking with his celebrity hero, Krusty the Clown. He's trying to remind him of how he knows him because they've met several times in the past. And Bart says, "I saved you from jail. I reunited you with your estranged father. I saved your career, man. Remember the comeback special?" And Krusty says, "Yeah, well, what have you done for me recently?" God's love should have been so completely obvious to them, especially when they look at what happened to the descendants of Esau. God's blessing and love were not given to that tribe. In fact, they had often wished harm on Israel or refused to help them in times of need, even though they were their distant relatives. As we're told in Psalm 137, "Remember, Lord, what the Edomites did on the day Jerusalem fell. Tear it down," they cried. "Tear it down to its foundations." But of course, they were not only speaking against the Israelites, but in wishing destruction on his holy city, they were also speaking against God. Our passage says that God hated Esau to show the difference between the love that God showed Israel and how he dealt with the Edomites, the descendants of Esau. Under David's reign, the Edomites were subjugated by David. In 2 Samuel chapter 8, verses 13 to 14, we are told, "And David became famous after he returned from striking down 18,000 Edomites in the Valley of Salt. He put garrisons throughout Edom, and all the Edomites became subject to David. The Lord gave David victory wherever he went." Later, however, under the reign of King Jehor, they revolted and regained their autonomy. But in reading through the Bible, we can continue to see God's hand against them. Consider these verses from Ezekiel. This is what the Sovereign Lord says. "Because Edom took revenge on Judah and became very guilty by doing so, therefore this is what the Sovereign Lord says. I will stretch out my hand against Edom and kill both man and beast. I will lay it waste, and from Teman to Dedan they will fall by the sword. I will take vengeance on Edom by the hand of my people Israel, and they will deal with Edom in accordance with my anger and my wrath. They will know my vengeance, declares the Sovereign Lord." Ezekiel 25 verses 12 to 14. And of course we know that Edom were also oppressed by the Babylonians. Now it may look as if the Israelites and the Edomites were treated in the same way, But we can see that God's love didn't leave Israel, and they had future blessings in store for them. But the same couldn't be said for Eden. The great reformer Calvin once said, "When God visits sins in common, that is common to the elect and those who are not elect, he ever moderates his wrath towards his elect and sets limits to his severity according to what he says. If his prosperity keep not my covenant, but profane my law, I will chastise them with the rod of man, but my mercy I will not take away from him." Israel should have seen the results of Edom not having God's love and blessing as they did in the past, but he will also show them the difference it will make in the future. Verses 4 to 5. Edom may say, "Though we have been crushed, we will rebuild the ruins." But this is what the Lord Almighty says. "They may build, but I will demolish. They will be called the wicked land, a people always under the wrath of the Lord. You will see it with your own eyes and say, 'Great is the Lord, even beyond the borders of Israel.'" It may have looked initially that their situations were the same coming out of exile. But the temple had been rebuilt in Jerusalem and the Israelites should have been filled with a feeling of hope. But there is no hope for Edom because they are under God's wrath. He promises that whatever they rebuild, he will destroy. They are a wicked land. And Israel will again see with their own eyes the difference between the way the two nations have been treated. It is also a reminder of the immense power of God. We say Malachi call him here Lord Almighty, which is sometimes translated in other places as Lord of Hosts or Lord of the Heavenly Armies. It is a title that is a favourite of Malachi's, and at one point in this book we see him use it 24 times in just 52 verses. God has unsurpassing power and authority, and Israel will again see that power in his dealing with their enemies, as indeed they did when Edom was finally destroyed by the Nabataeans in around 312 BC. And they will again say, "Great is the Lord in the whole world, not just within the borders of Israel." God has indeed loved Israel with the great covenantal love as promised to their ancestors. But already within just a few short verses of this prophecy, we can see that they haven't kept their love for God in the same way. And so God has sent his prophet Malachi to bring them this prophecy, a burden to carry them, wait for them to carry, to bring them to repentance. As Leighton Ford once said, God loves us the way we are, but too much to leave us that way. As we work through Malachi's prophecy, we will see it is a great book to read through on the build up to Christmas. It is the last book of the Old Testament, and it's often said that it comes before a silence for God for 400 years, before one that Malachi himself prophesied will come as a messenger, preparing the way for the one who is the ultimate proof of God's love for Israel and for us. "For he so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life." John 3:16. In the same way that God chose Israel to show his love to, so he has chosen to pour out his love onto us. We too are chosen, elected in Christ, as Paul made clear to the church in Rome. "For not all who are descended from Israel are Israel, nor because they are his descendants are they all Abraham's children. On the contrary, it is through Isaac that your offspring will be reckoned." In other words, it is not the children by physical descent who are God's children, but it is the children of the promise who are regarded as Abraham's offspring. For this was how the promise was stated: "At the appointed time I will return, and Sarah will have a son." Not only that, but Rebekah's children were conceived at the same time by our father Isaac. Yet before the twins were born, or had done anything good or bad, in order that God's purpose and election might stand, not by works but by him who calls, she was told, the older will serve the younger. Just as it is written, Jacob I have loved, but Esau I hated. What then shall we say? Is God unjust? Not at all. For he says to Moses, I have mercy on whom I have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I have compassion. It does not therefore depend on human desire or effort, but on God's mercy. Romans chapter 9, verses 6 to 16. How we should continually thank our Heavenly Father for his love and mercy towards us, which he evidences in so many ways, but very particularly in Jesus' sacrifice for us on the cross, for the forgiveness of our sins. And that through his resurrection, we too have the promise of eternal life, if only we turn to him. We should strive to ensure that all of our thoughts and words and actions always speak of our love for him, because we are his people, chosen to be loved and kept in Jesus Christ, who died to become our Saviour. Shall we pray? Dear Lord, we thank you so much for your constant love towards us, that despite the times we sin and turn away from you, you have never turned away from us. We thank you that because of your great love for us, you sent Jesus so we can be forgiven of our sins and be reconciled to you. Please help us to love you as we ought and to show our love for you in the way that we live our lives, so that not only you but others can see our love and devotion to you, and that is also reflected in the way we love each other. We pray this in the name of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. So let's finish with a song that proclaims that great truth. How deep the Father's love for us.
I will boast in Jesus Christ.
and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom.
Thank you once again for joining with us this afternoon. Now may Christ dwell in our hearts through faith, and I pray that we, being rooted and established in love, may have power, together with all the Lord's holy people, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know that this love that surpasses knowledge, that we may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Amen.